Pleased to bring you our feature presentation.
Well, hello. I almost didn't see you there. You must be my special guest promised to me this evening. Welcome to my laboratory. Please give me a few moments before we continue with introductions.
Hildegard, you were meant to be a poet and the
so, what do you do? You're new. I'm old.
Do you know the doors?
The doors to what? Perception?
Yeah.
No, but I'd like to go through one of them.
One thing that I'm surprised to have not noticed or find is a declared link between the ideals and developments of Bohemianism with modern paganism. Which, if you know anything about Bohemianism and its values, is that a lot of what makes up the mindset of most pagan communities have been derived or adopted through the influences of Bohemian ideals that formed in Paris during the 19th century. The American College Dictionary defines Bohemianism as a person with artistic or intellectual tendencies, who lives and acts with no regard for conventional rules or behavior. And it is a term which was also often associated with the gypsies, who immigrated to Paris during the 19th century. This type of free-spirited lifestyle was naturally practiced by musicians, artists, actors, journalists, poets, and other writers who, like the gypsies of France, settled in the lower rent districts of Paris. Those individuals who became known as Bohemians in French society were an unusual sort because they most often chose to live in an impoverished lifestyle, so that they could fully pursue their passions, whatever they happened to be, despite some of them having been from wealthy families. Imagery from then that illustrates the Bohemian lifestyle depicts a person focused and working on something in a poorly furnished and often dirty and disorderly room. The idea being that they were too wrapped up in what they were doing to need furniture, to bathe, or to clean their home. As Bohemianism spread across the world due to immigration, Bohemian communities formed in some of the major cities of the United States, such as New York and even San Francisco, where an organization by the name of the Bohemian Club was established in April of 1872. It was established for journalists who wished to promote a fraternal connection among men who enjoyed the arts. Apparently, the club still exists to this day, and it is where celebrities, politicians, and even presidents convene on a yearly basis, which conspiracy theorists love to attack and ridicule because of the pagan-like ceremonies practiced at the club for communal purposes of its members. Theorists claim that this is where the major decisions that affect the world are made by its leaders. similar to claims made about the Freemasons, Skull and Bones, and the more mythical Illuminati by the same theorists. In the 19th and early 20th centuries, some Bohemians also practiced free love, and the Bohemian movement even gave way to gender bending, with women donning shorter boyish hairstyles. This trend even affected women's clothing, which went from elaborate, heavy, and uncomfortable dresses typical of the Victorian era to trousers, brassieres, and the more simple, economical attire, which were not only more comfortable, but were also practical for the financial hardships of the times. Also in keeping with the period and opening social consciousness, it was the perfect time for naturism to come to the United States, after having started in Europe years earlier, where bare bottoms, bums, breasts, and other such fancies began to respectably see the light of day at retreats and private gatherings in the States. With bohemianism settling in the US, its already carefree quality became more mainstream, which filtered into the roaring 1920s, and then into the post-World War beatnik, Art Deco, and jazz movements. The beatniks of the 1950s gave way to the hippie movement of the late 1960s, with its flower power, free love, and psychedelics. It was at this time in history where many modern pagan ideals and popular New Age perspectives grew forth from. Starting in San Francisco, California in 1967, the hippie movement spread across the globe, similar to its predecessors, revealing it as a staple of the times. Books like The Hobbit and the Lord of the Rings series by J.R.R. Tolkien and Stranger in a Strange Land by Robert A. Heinlein were very influential during this time, though their initial publishing occurred years prior, during the beatnik period of the 1950s. And typical of such a large counterculture movement, which was initially rejected and looked down upon over time, it became commonplace as the old ways gave way to those of the new. Such a shift in consciousness became evident in television, music, and film, as the once treasured sanctity of the counterculture got devoured and consumed by the media as an offering to the new way of life. Other significant aspects of the hippie movement was its exploration of drugs like marijuana and various psychedelics, art, music, and other forms of self-expression, the promotion of peace and protesting, embracing and exploring Eastern philosophies and alternative religions, environmental awareness, Gaia consciousness, as well as the occult and those interests and practices, which are often associated with the New Age movement of today. Not to mention the common theme of hippie names, which bear a striking similarity in content and style to the many magical names chosen and used by pagans of today. A majority of pagan festivals and events can even be viewed as the reliving of the famous rock festivals of the 1960s, with their music, celebration, nudity, crafts, and public sex. I think by now you've already begun to recognize the similarities between the ideals, practices, habits, and fascinations of the pagan community with those of bohemianism, as it has evolved and moved through the generations. Not to mention how some pagans even have a hippie quality about them, whether that is evident in their appearance, level of personal hygiene, or both. And if you're not sure if this applies to you, don't worry, your friends most likely do. After all, who wouldn't acknowledge or state that paganism is a counterculture movement, and that in many situations, people have had to make familial, social, and even career sacrifices or adaptations in order to pursue their path? Though many of us haven't chosen a life of poverty in order to be pagan, social and personal sacrifices have been made by many, if not all pagans, since they chose to be pagan. So it's plain to see that many bohemian ideals have made their way through the course of time, and have found a warm friend within paganism, and in those who call themselves pagans. Similar to the hippies of the 1960s, we can be sure that if paganism continues to grow, it may one day be regarded and treated as a social norm.
Seven, eight.